is a busy, stimulus-filled place. We have information blaring at us from our laptops, from our smartphones, from our tablets, everywhere. It can be really overwhelming. And if you have autism, it can be downright paralyzing. Our next speaker is John Foxe. He's the chair of our Department of Neuroscience here at the university. And his research focuses on how all of that information streaming in from our senses connects to our ability to communicate. He's here to share a little bit about what he's learned recently and how that can help people with autism thrive in their own social interactions. Please join me in welcoming John Foxe.
Thank you, Nick. Well, hello, thank you for that nice welcome. It's a real privilege to be here to share a little bit about something that I'm very passionate about, and the folks in my lab have been very passionate about researching over the last 10 to 15 years, and that is how the sensory systems are knit together. How does sight, sound, touch, smell, balance, how does the brain integrate those, and what happens in individuals where this doesn't work appropriately? So when a scientist like me gets, you know, 400 or 500 people in a room like this, the best thing to do is to run an experiment. So let's give that a go. So you're going to hear in a moment something quite noisy. It's not just because we make we're very poor at making videos. It's because they're actually purposefully noisy. And buried in that noise, with a little shh, you'll hear a monosyllabic word, a single syllable word. See if you can recognize it. Maybe don't call it out if you do. Okay, can I have the first?
Flush.
So you heard the noise, you heard the sound in there, the word, maybe a little bit indiscriminate, difficult to recognize. So now I'm going to play exactly the same soundtrack, no tricks, but this time you can watch Vicky saying the word.
Flush.
And I think you'll have noticed there just how much it pops, right? It pops out nicely, so the folks know that that was class participation time, thank you. So flush, right, and difficult to recognize the first time, quite clear the second time. And of course, what have you got? You've got access to the visual information, and your brain's knitting those two sources of information together. There are specialized neurons in the brain that allow for this to happen. Our brain is an information scavenger. It's grabbing as much information as it can to help you to navigate your environment. Let's give another one a quick go there. I completely recognize this every time because I've heard it a million times. I don't know about you guys. How about try it again with the video? The bottom right, thank you.
Yeah.
Right, and you see it pop again. So let's do some data. So you guys just participated in just two instances of this experiment that I'm going to describe to you now. There are about 500 monosyllabic words in the English lexicon. And they're great words because pretty much everybody knows all of them. They're the simple words, right? So that means you can use them in kids or folks who have a disease, and they get them. They know them. So here's let's look at this graph over here. And on the right here, this zero, this is auditory alone performance. And these are adults now, just folks like yourselves. And what you see is that zero here is when there's quite a lot of noise, but folks are recognizing 80, 90% of these. But as we add noise, -4, -8, you can see performance is dropping until at -24 here, this -24 decibels, not a single person recognizes a single one of these words. So we've got a nice assay, a nice test of multisensory speech processing here. And this is auditory alone performance. You throw the video in just like you saw, and performance goes way up. So the only math I'm going to ask you to perform today as University of Rochester graduates is subtraction. Let's subtract this curve here from this one up here, and you end up with this down here. And this is the difference, right? The difference. And you can see here at this -12 mark that there's a huge improvement. What actually happens here is you go from recognizing one word in five to recognizing about four words in five. And that's the difference between not being able to tell what somebody's saying to you and being completely able to interpret what they're saying. Four out of five, you'll get there. You'll understand. So now, let's have a look at what happens when we do this in children. So the same kinds of graphs. Here's auditory alone. And what we have here are adults in this light gray. We have teenagers, or preteens, 11 and 12-year-olds, in this darker gray. And here are a bunch of 5, 6, and 7-year-olds. And so by and large, the 5, 6, and 7-year-olds, NN means no noise, are performing pretty good. You know, they're getting 80% of these words correct, pretty much like adults. And you can see again, you get all the way down here, nothing recognized. Put the video track in, there are the adults, the 11-year-olds, the 6-year-olds. So a real dissociation. Let's perform our complex computation again. We're going to subtract those two curves. And here are the adults, here are the preteens, and here are the kids. So the first thing to notice here is that even in children as old as 10, 11, 12 years of age, this isn't fully mature. This multisensory speech integration ability takes a long time to come online. And certainly the 6 and 7-year-olds, they're not getting anything like the benefit from watching a speaker that an adult is. So the next time you're screaming at the kids at home, remember this curve. It might not just be as dire as you think. Okay, so now we have a good way to test multisensory speech integration with this experiment you participated in. Why would we study it in autism spectrum disorder? And it's pretty straightforward and probably self-evident, really. Audiovisual speech perception is important for communication. We don't usually sit in an environment like this where everybody's being very polite and very quiet most of the time. We typically are interacting in very noisy environments. Now, I don't know what the dinner table at your household is like, but at my household, there's usually 17 or 18 different conversations going on across each other. And that's what the playground's like. That's what the cafeteria's like. The sidewalk in the street with the cars whizzing by. Most of the time, we're trying to hear things while there's a lot of other information, auditory information out there. So it's important for speech communication. And of course, as you well know, impairment in communication is one of the hallmark symptoms of autism spectrum disorder. You, in fact, have to have an impairment in communication to pick up a diagnosis of autism. And actually, this idea has been around for a very long time. It's been around since the 1970s. There were a lot of very popular books written at the time, one by Jean Ayres, The Out of Sync Child. You might remember that terminology. And parents will often say, I think my child doesn't put the sensory systems together. And even folks on the spectrum, high-functioning folks on the spectrum, will say the same thing about themselves. So that's quite anecdotal. So let's see, is that what actually happens? So here are a group of 7, 8, and 9-year-olds, a good few of them on the spectrum here, with a diagnosed autism spectrum disorder. And TD here means typically developing. So these are your average kids from the school, the local school. There's the auditory alone performance. In no noise, they're performing just the same, basically. And as we add the noise, they go down to zero, just like the typically developing kids. And I think you'll appreciate that there's no difference here between the kids on the spectrum and the kids who are developing typically. Let's throw in that video track, and you can see where this is going. Let's perform our complex computation. We'll subtract the curves. And there you have these young kids now, 8 years of age, 7, 8, 9 years of age, with their multisensory gain, the benefit that they're getting from having the integration of the two systems. And as you can see, the kids on the spectrum are nowhere near that performance. And you'll recall that I told you already that 7, 8, and 9-year-olds don't really have a very mature multisensory system. But boy, these kids on the spectrum are way behind. Let's move up the age bracket. What's happening at 10, 11, and 12 years of age? Auditory alone, so when they don't have the video, we'll put in the video track, maybe. And you can see the separation. Again, when we do our subtraction, the children on the spectrum, these preteen children, are way behind their typically developing peers. Let's step up another age bracket, 13, 14, 15 years. So now these kids who've entered and gone into puberty, we have a look at their auditory alone performance, put in the video track, and I think you'll appreciate that that's very different. Let's do our subtraction, and the kids have completely caught up. Now, this was a huge surprise to us. We were really stunned by this. We absolutely assumed that the teenage kids would have the deficit. So there's something going on here. And of course, as a scientist, I'd like to be able to stand here and tell you I've got the answer, but I don't. We don't know what this is about. We do know, let me just add one other thing, because I know somebody's going to say to me, well, wait a minute. I know that children on the spectrum don't like to look at faces. So that's all you've got here. They weren't looking at those faces you were presenting to them. So of course they didn't get a multisensory speech integration. But what we do is we use an infrared eye tracker to make sure, that they're looking at the stimuli, and indeed they do, and they look at it in exactly the same way as folks, as typically developing children. So what is going on in this older group? And I said, I don't really know. What I do know, and what we've known for quite some time, is that there are massive changes in brain organization as children enter puberty. I've gone through them with two of my own children, and it's not always pleasant. So for example, here's just one set of data from another group where you can see that actually blood flow into the brain around the age of 12, 13 years of age really drops in typical development. Do we know if that's occurring in autism spectrum disorder? We also know that there's massive myelination, there's massive amount of coding of the wires in the brain, if you will, around this age bracket as well. So we're busy trying to figure this out at this moment in time. So let me conclude here. What do we know? We know that multisensory speech integration abilities are severely impaired in school-aged children with an autism spectrum disorder. These multisensory integration abilities are crucial for interacting effectively with peers, especially when there are multiple speakers or there's a background noise involved. It is possible that this contributes to the social communication deficits that are a hallmark of autism, and I'd say it's almost certain that they do, frankly. There's a dramatic recovery of this function in adolescence, perhaps due to major brain changes that occur during puberty. We need to explicitly measure that. Now, here's the thing. The fact that the ability can be recovered is, I take it as an extremely hopeful sign, because what it means is that it's unlikely that there's something fundamentally wrong with the brain. The brain ultimately figures out this task, important task. So what that says to me is, if we could start training these children at a much earlier age, maybe we could bring them online with this ability. And maybe by doing that, we might be able to improve their social skills. So that's the thesis. And we currently have a $3 million NIH grant where we're working very hard delivering multisensory integration therapy to children on the spectrum to see if that is what pans out. So stay tuned. Hopefully I'll be able to tell you about that again at some other time. Thank you very much.